respond to hunger, because life has its own protocol, and that is why it's important to maximize the protocol of life every time it's activated. So I want to do a teaching to teach us and to make us understand what this thing happening in the East is all about. So you don't just run around in the prayer meeting, carry chairs on your head. It's deeper than that. Are we together? So lift your hands toward heaven and whisper to the Father. Evangelist Lawrence was teaching very important principles. I wish I was here from the beginning, but of course I will listen to the tape. And I'm sure you learn something and you will put that to work. Vrahazizi, Varahakozi, Valaya, Zinzahave, Lahave, Sanak, Banda Kiba Rahastov, Radidi Zanzali, Brahada Kavar, Mandaria, Bradidi Zanzavrodo Kira, Baradina, Shavai. Talk to the Lord from the depths of your heart. Open your spirit. You can lock your spirit and you can open your spirit. It's a spiritual intelligence. Deliberately open your spirit to receive. Mande kira paraziva hasevate. Marakido brazadina vrandadina varada. Thank you, precious Holy Spirit, for tonight. We ask that you help us to glean wisdom as you grant us access into the place of wisdom. We ask that you empower us and invigorate us by your word and cause our understanding to be enlightened. Take all the praise, take all the glory in Jesus' precious name. Amen. You may be seated. Life is spiritual. We were created and fashioned from the spirit and cast into time to give expression to purposes that were born in the spirit. We were created of a spirit with a spiritual essence to give expression to purposes that are spiritual, even though we were created to live in a natural realm. If we don't understand the spirituality of life, we will be overtaken by the activities that natural existence give expression to. A lot of spiritual intelligence and wisdom went into your design. And the reason is because God does not just want you to give expression to his purposes as a robot. So while you are giving expression to the will of God, you are also living life, and you are also finding meaning in the course of giving expression to the will of God. But if you do not understand that, first of all, you are spiritual, and that you are here to give expression to a purpose that is spiritual, you may begin to live your life according to the sequences that are set in motion by your emotion. Because your emotion can determine the direction of your life. Your thought patterns can determine the direction of your life. Friends can determine the direction of your life. The environment you find yourself can determine the direction of your life. And you will be cut off from the vital connection of the spirit realm from whence you were sent as an apostle into time. You know, it's natural because you are in Abba here to take the life and occupation of business, because the environment predominantly casts its weight upon you, and that environment will determine your thought patterns. That environment will determine your philosophies and your ideologies, and you will live in this environment as a businessman all your life, and you wouldn't make contact with the reason for which you were born, because you did not understand that life is spiritual. So instead of journeying back into the spirit to find out the purpose of God for your existence, you would have discovered that you gave expression to purposes that were fabricated by the environment where you found yourself, and your environment became the essence of your existence. And if you live like that, you have breathed oxygen and you have walked through time. But as far as the scales of God are concerned, you did not exist. That's the burden of existence. The burden of existence is that you can determine the path that you should go, And you can also determine to choose the path that was preordained before your existence. These two channels are ahead of you and they will perpetually be there. When you become wise, you are not full of knowledge and intelligence. When you become wise, you are able to look into the spirit and to isolate the counsel of God for your life. Wisdom in the days of old is not a function of knowledge. Wisdom in the days of old is your ability to look into the spirit realm and to isolate counsels that are immortal. So a wise man in the days of the fathers was not a man that was well read and well studied. A wise man in the days of the fathers is a man that can look into the spirit realm and say, this is what God wants. This is what God is saying. This is where God will have us go. And most times it didn't make sense. Most times they journeyed to places they did not even know their destination. The Bible said Abraham was looking for a city that had foundation, whose builder and maker was God. He didn't know where he was going to. But he said he left from tent to tent, carrying his sons, Isaac and Jacob. That was a wise man. Abraham came from the halls of the Chaldees. These were people that were given to idolatry. They were people that understood government. They understood politics. They understood business. So much so that in the land of Shinar, they already started a project of building a tower that reached into the heavens. So they were not novices. They had explored the earth realm and they know that there is nothing in the earth that could fascinate them anymore. So they said, let's journey to beyond the clouds and find out the things that exist there. That means that by reason of intelligence, by reason of study, by reason of gathering of facts and research, they had explored the whole earth. So nothing on earth could fascinate them anymore. The only thing that could catch their fancy was to find out what exists beyond the cloud. And they wanted to build a tower that transcended the cloud. But among these people, God called Abraham out. And Abraham was able to turn his back at what was called a predominant civilization. And he journeyed and was seeking for a God that could not be seen, whose form could not be discerned. All he had was the voice of God. That was a wise man. And in this conference, one of the things the Lord will be doing for you is to make you a wise man. Is to make you a wise man. You know, we are so daft that even when the little things like where to live, who to marry, we can't discern our wives. We can't discern our location. We can't discern the essence of our existence. That's how backward we are as far as spiritual intelligence is concerned. Because spiritual intelligence is not the gathering of knowledge. It's actually the ability to tap into the spirit and to isolate the counsel of God. And that's what I'm trusting the Lord will happen to somebody tonight. Genesis chapter 2 verse 15. Genesis chapter 2 verse 15. He said, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. The word dress is the Hebrew word abadi, and the word keep is the Hebrew word shamar. These two words have their original meaning beyond what was captured in that scripture. When God said to dress the garden, the emphasis of God was actually for the man to keep the garden aligned to heaven. So much so that when you looked upon the garden was a replica of heaven. The reason is because that garden was downloaded from Zion. So the job of the man is to keep the garden connected to Zion, so that the life force that regulated Zion will be the life force that regulated that garden. So it was an assignment of priesthood. Dress the garden is not to cut the flower. No. Dress the garden is to make sure the garden sustain a uniform position, such that if God migrated from Eden of heaven into Eden of time, there will be no difference. That's why that garden had no gate. He said in Genesis chapter 2, from verse 9, it said, in the cool of the day, the voice of God came walking in the garden. How the voice of God entered the garden, you could not tell. How the voice of God came out of the garden, you do not know. The voice of God just came walking in the garden. And God will commune with the man. Genesis 3, verse 8 and 9, he came walking in the garden. Now, the reason God could access the garden was because the garden was an extension of heaven. And if you study the book of Ezekiel chapter 38 from verse 17, God was speaking to Lucifer. And he began to tell Lucifer, how that he was in Eden, the mountain of God. That means Eden was not something God planted in time. Eden was something God downloaded from heaven. But Eden cannot survive except Eden is connected to Zion. So when God said, dress the garden, what God was telling the man was to keep the garden vitally connected to heaven so that the same life that rules heaven will be the life that rules the garden. Because if that man fails in his assignment of priesthood, the garden will be truncated from heaven and the garden will suffer corruption. It will become like the earth. The earth that existed apart from God. Remember, before God began the project of recreating the earth had been corrupt. In Genesis chapter 2 from verse 1, chapter 1 from verse 2, the Bible said that the voice of God was brooding upon the face of the deep and the earth was without form and void. So if the earth is separated from heaven, the earth will become without form and void. That's the same thing that happens to your life. If your life becomes disconnected from heaven, other spirits will migrate into your life and your life will become a theater that gives expression to them. You know, the sister that gave word of knowledge said, that sister said whenever she has an encounter, she discovers she falls into immorality. The reason is because there is no priesthood in her life. So the download of God that comes in forms of an encounter, because that door is open, another spirit comes in and corrupts it. So it doesn't matter what God drops. No matter how beautiful the garden is, if the job of priesthood is not intact, everything God brought was a waste. A prophet can become a waste. An apostle can become a waste. A president, potential president, can become a waste if he did not understand what God meant when he said, dress the garden. And Adam took priesthood for granted and another spirit came into the garden. You know, the way God locks a door is not by shutting it. The way God locks a door is by putting a mystery around it. So he said, if the princes of this world had known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. So you will see Jesus, you will not know. In fact, you will want to kill him and end his ministry. But you do not know that by killing him, you have advanced the ministry. So you will be seeing it, but you will not understand it. It was Apostle Lawrence that was telling us yesterday that when God hides something, it's not because it's not known, but it is veiled. So when he said, dress the garden, what it meant was that keep the garden secured by the mystery of priesthood. And when he said, keep it, what it meant was that provide legislation in this garden. That's the job of kingship, the job of dominion, the job of rulership. You are not just preserving this garden, but you will cause this garden to dominate the earth. The garden is supposed to advance from a little atmosphere and dominate the earth. And everything I'm sharing with you begins with your life, and I will connect it to your life. You know, some years ago, you were going through 90 days retreat. What you were doing is that you were plugging your life to heaven, plugging your life to heaven. The day the life of heaven dominated you, it became impossible to keep it in your vessel. So you started spreading it. So it's when you dress that you can keep. The moment you connect Eden to heaven, the next thing, Eden will naturally begin to spread. So you didn't invite me because you love me. You invited me because I kept this garden. So this thing in me will spread naturally. It will spread. If I want it to spread higher now, I know what to do. I can change the intensity of this meeting now. You know what? I've mastered how to keep this garden. So I know a sound that if I touch that sound, the energy that is locked up in this vessel will begin to spread. I know how to pray in tongues that I will begin to trouble the water in my spirit, and the water will begin to affect people. Because what happens is, the intelligence of spreading is the intelligence of resonance. For those who are science students, they understand. You know, you are at your own frequency now. I am at my own frequency now. But there is something you can do. If you begin to chant now, what you will do is that you will bring me under the influence of your frequency. So the same thing you are feeling, I'll begin to feel it. When you give somebody word of knowledge, you are not trying to give him a word that he doesn't know. You are actually in a realm of knowledge where secrets don't exist. So what you are speaking to the person, what you are doing is that you are bringing the person into that same realm. So what you know, the person knows. And sometimes when they know what you say, they collapse. They were at their own frequency, they were comfortable until you came and you touched them. And when you touch them, you hijack them to your own frequency. And the current of God that you are conducting, they are not used to that current. That's why they collapse under the anointing. It's called resonance. So the garden can't spread until it is first of all dressed. And the way the garden is dressed is priesthood. The moment the job of priesthood is completed, the job of kingship is natural. So when we come out, we don't apologize to demons. We don't negotiate with them. We command them to get out. If I want to do an impartation now, I say, Lord, touch. You know why Lord, touch is possible? Through priesthood that have resonated with God's frequency. So when I'm saying touch, I'm bringing God's frequency to you. That is rulership. Those were the assignment God gave Adam in the garden. He said, dress the garden and keep it. Adam received an energy he didn't work for, because God created him in his image and in his likeness. So that energy Adam began to spend from it. He came and he began kingship. Meanwhile, he violated priesthood. And then he came, he said, you are lion. And when they checked in God's lexicon, it was lion. He slept and he woke up and he saw Eve. He said, you shall be called woman, because you were taken out of the man. He was sleeping. But he was functioning by an energy. You are not aware of something because you are awake. You are aware of something because you are in that realm. So even while you are sleeping, the realm has a way of interacting with you. That's why even when you are sleeping, you can be receiving intelligence. So Adam was sleeping and he woke up. He said, ah, you shall be called woman, because you were taken out of the man. He said, this is the bone of my bone. How did he know? The flesh of my flesh. How did he know? He was plugged to an energy. But he didn't know that to keep that thing working, priesthood must be added. So he was keeping the garden without dressing it. And when he kept it, a point came when another being showed up with a higher energy level. Because at this time, his energy had begun to deplete. And he said to the woman, did God say that you should not eat of the fruit that is in the garden? The woman said, we should not even eat, neither should we touch it. In the day that we eat, we shall die. That's Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 to 7. And he said, you shall not surely die. He didn't say you shall not die. He said, you shall not surely die. For God does know that in the day that you eat of this fruit, you will become as wise as God, knowing good and evil. And the Bible said the man was there with her. You know why the man could no longer advance? What the man would have done naturally was to attend to the matter, because the woman was not the head. He was the head. But every time the woman becomes the head, priesthood have been violated. If you study 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he said, be ye followers of me, even as I am the follower of Christ. He said, Christ belongs to God. Man belongs to Christ. The woman belongs to man. That's priesthood. It's not trying to place people in cadres in order to make them feel less of themselves. It's just showing them the order of preservation. Without priesthood, preservation can never be possible. So when the serpent came, it was the woman that was engaging the serpent. That was a statement that the man had lost priesthood. And when the serpent gave the woman the fruit, he said she ate it and gave to her husband that was there with her. And the man ate it. And both of them became damned. And when God came naturally in the cool of the day, in verse 8, Genesis chapter 3, the man now hid himself. You know why? The moment he resonated with another frequency, it became difficult for him to resonate with God. And God said, where are thou? Remember, the one who is speaking is the omniscient one. He knows all things. So where are thou does not mean where are you. Where are thou simply means you are no longer occupying your throne in the spirit. Because the moment priesthood was lost, rulership also is lost. I can't see you in your throne. When I looked upon the galaxies where the princes of Zion dwell, you are absent. So when the Holy One began to inquire, where are thou? He's not saying, where is your location? He's saying, your scepter is empty. What has happened to your authority? Something had gone wrong. Priesthood had been lost. And when God saw it, the man could no longer dress and keep the garden. So the best thing to do was to roll the garden back to heaven. So the garden vanished. That's what happens to your calling. When you don't dress and keep your life, after a while, if your priesthood is destroyed, then your calling is rolled up and it goes back to heaven. And after a long time, somebody else will come and through alignment hit the frequency where that calling can find expression, and the same calling will rest on the person. Did you read the story of Reinhard Bonnke? He said when he came to Africa, there was a great evangelist that was doing terrible things, but at some point the man wanted to do other things, and the calling rolled up. And when Brian had bunk it through alignment, pressed and hit that energy level, the thing alighted on him, because the calling are not sensitive to men. They are ordinations. Any man that fits into that ordination will walk in the reality. But the way to do it is by priesthood and kingship. So when you say it's Watchman Conference, I wanted to teach about the place of priesthood. The job of priesthood, the life of intercession, is an order in the spirit. And we call it the order of the keepers. Intercession is an order in the spirit. Not many Christians journey there. Don't be deceived. We are all Christians. We are all saved, but we are not the same in spiritual cadre. When you enter into a kingdom, your value is not that you are born into that kingdom. Your value is the assignment that can be committed to you in that kingdom. The law of honor resonates on service. And the greatest service in the kingdom is the service of keeping the purposes of God. That is the assignment of intercession. Intercessors are keepers. And there are five cadre in the business of intercession. You will not have honor with God until you can keep spiritual verities. Not many people can keep things. Men hide things in banks, but when God hides things, he hides them in men. Men are the votes where God hides things. A gift of the spirit is something that God hides. It's a dimension of God. So when God wants to preserve it, there is no place in heaven where he will preserve it. It's in men. When God wants to secure authority, it's in men he hides it. When God wants to secure power, it's in men he hides it. That's why he said he pleased the Father that the fullness of the Godhead should dwell in Christ bodily. So the dimensions of God, remember, God can't be trapped in heaven. The Bible said he eternity dwells in him. He said in 2 Kings chapter 8 verse 27, he said, can God dwell in heaven? He said the earth is his footstool. So where can God hide himself? The only place where God hides things is in men. So he said he pleased the Father, Colossians 1:19, 2:9, that the fullness of the Godhead should dwell in him bodily. When a spirit wants to hide things, it begins to look for men. And the men that spirits can entrust with things are keepers. It's not everybody. It's not everybody. That's why when you chant, nothing happens. When Lawrence chant, things happen. It's not about the chant. It's what was hid in you. Peter was entering the temple with John. He said, look on us. Silver and gold have I none. He said, but such as I have. All of us, we preach the Bible. But your ministry is not the teaching of the Bible. Your ministry is the delivery of what you have with God. What do you have with God? Keepers are the end time warriors. And one of the gates into keeping is intercession. What are you keeping for God? What are you keeping for God? That's the question of existence. What are you keeping for God? What has God hid on your inside? It means there's no priesthood. If we look at you and we can't trace a dimension, there's no priesthood. It means God have not committed anything to you. You can open this Bible and preach it for 50 years. You will not be relevant. Even the princes in darkness will know you are a talker. Because there are many theologians that know this scripture more than many apostles. The power is not in how well you can journey in scripture. The power is what you have with God. What do you carry? What is the dimension of God you have been entrusted with? He said, such as I have with God, I have fire. I'm a custodian of mysteries. I don't know what I know because I read. Mystery is a place. Everything in God is in a realm. There is something we call the body of knowledge. As you begin to journey in God, there's a place where sound exists. There's a place. Sound is not volume. Sound is a realm of knowledge. So when you enter into the economy of the body of knowledge, you journey and then you come where sound is. And there are some sounds that produce worship. There are some other sounds that are sounds of war. So he said, when the trumpet makes an unusual sound, who will prepare for battle? It's a sound of war. When two people chant, the manifestations are different. One of them may be a provoker of worship. Another one is a provoker of war.
So when that man begins to chant, warriors begin to arise. Have you been there? You may be sleeping. It might be a vigil until the man begins to chant. And when he's chanting, from your spirit, you begin to sense a vibration. And what happens is that you carry your boots in the spirit. And then he goes higher. And then you carry your bracelet of righteousness. He goes higher. And then you carry your helmet. And after 5 minutes, you find yourself. Kadaka. A man is chanting the songs of war. So what he's doing is that he's summoning men. It's not a chant. It's a summon. Because where he entered in that body of knowledge is the place where sound dwell. There's a realm in Zion. It's called the room of wine. There are many who go there. They are keepers of righteousness. If you enter the room of wine, whenever you speak, men are drunk. They can come as adulterers. They can come as fornicators. But the problem, oh my God, the problem is not that you are talking. The problem is that when you talk, you are a server of wine. So you are giving out shots. And sometimes the wine can come intoxicated. Then you see people running. They can't hold themselves. You say, catch them, catch them. It's impossible. You have entered the room of wine. The room where wine dwells. You know there. So every time you begin to pray, your own is not speaking in tongues. You are journeying in the spirit. You are journeying. And when you enter that road, you can recognize some features there. Because you have been there before. It is the altar of the keepers. Every one of us has a potential of walking in this order. But how many are willing to pay the price? How many are willing? Kakiro parakina. Bandiga vakizo vakask. Dadali dadandali gavak. Omari atede sadidi zagade. Dagadida gadaga zidi gadana shaka. Rianote paraki. Vadega zinda zizana. Rakida porakina datandi gadava. Such as I have with God. Such as I have with God. That's your ministry. But you will not have anything with God unless you begin to walk in the order of the keepers. The first realm in the order of keepers is the realm of intercessors. Intercessors are not men of prayer. Intercessors are men who can articulate buttons in the heart of God and they crystallize those buttons as prayer. If a man cannot tap into the realm of bodies, he can never be an intercessor. That is why I said all of us can be born again, but only few of us will walk in this order. How many of you can join into a realm where you can pick the bodies of God, the vibrations of the spirit, the emphasis in the heart of the Father? That's the first realm in the order of keepers. So every time God has a body, the way God discharges that body is that he looks for you. It can be 1 a.m. in the morning, but the Lord has a body. And when he has a body, it doesn't matter if you are having a dream. The angels will tap you, wake up. The Father has a body. That's why they are called keepers. You know, Lawrence was sharing yesterday something the Holy Ghost taught me some weeks ago. He said prayer begins with consciousness. You have not started praying until the consciousness of Zion is activated. And when that consciousness is activated, the second layer of prayer is yieldedness. So you yield to the Holy Ghost and it begins to flow through you. It's that flow of the Holy Ghost that you communicate as word. The first order of the keepers is the order of intercession. And intercessors are discerners of bodies. If you study the Old Testament, when the high priest enters into the Holy of Holies, in the effort, he has two stones called the Urim and the Tumim. What it does is that as he touches the Urim and the Tumim, he's waiting for the vibration, because God will come in form of the Shekinah and he will rest on the mercy seat. And when God rests there, the stones begin to glow. And when he touches it, he knows what the Father is doing and he begins to align. That's intercession. Meanwhile, very few of us are intercessors. You can pray for 5 hours by discipline. That is beautiful, but you have not started journeying. See, the places I've been to in the spirit, if I visit there again, I know. Why others pray in tongues and they keep track with time? Others journey in Zion. Father, where will you take me beyond this realm? Every day I pray, this is where I stop. I want to go further. So the reason he increased the retreat to 6 months is because he wants to travel further. And when he travels further, his manifestation will bear testimony that he has gone far. Elijah came. He said, I'm very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for they have destroyed thy altars. They have killed thy prophets. What is that? Meanwhile, Elijah, the Bible said in James chapter 5 verse 16 and 17, that is a man subject to like passion, just as we are. But something had happened to him. His spiritual DNA had been altered. So when Elijah is quiet, don't assume that somebody made him angry. When Elijah is quiet, it's because God is quiet. When Elijah roars, it's because God is roaring. So his life becomes keeping pace with the Father. Keeping pace with the Father. That's an intercessor. Jesus went to Gethsemane, and the Bible said the weight was heavy upon him until the clock of his sweat was like blood. And he said, Father, not my will, but thine. He was resonating with the burden in the heart of God. And when he caught that burden, he began to speak. Your intercession will not be potent until you can capture the burdens in the heart of God. It is the first realm in the order of keepers. And that's why when God finds such men, the whole heaven will move on their account. Not every man can be killed. Not every man. There are certain men that if you want to kill them, God can cause an angel to appear visibly. God can violate the law between the dimensions, and an angel will show up visibly and slap you. Abraham went to Egypt, and the king wanted to take his wife. Abraham was afraid and said, my sister, go so that we don't die. In the night, God came. He said, that is a prophet. You are a dead man. Return that man's wife. That is God, not an angel. God moved immediately because keepers are scarce. They are scarce. Keepers are scarce. There can be 10 million Christians. Maybe you can't find 5 keepers. They have become so regulated that sometimes they can't even think on their own. Keepers, they are scarce. And he said, he made everybody in the house, including animals, barren. That you touch his wife, all the women in your house are barren, including the animals. Animals are innocent in the matter, but it doesn't count. You have touched something that is sensitive in the eyes of God. You are daring an intercessor. If that man goes, how can God manage his burdens? When God wants to offload burden, do you know the burden God has for Abba? Do you think God is not seeing the number of fornicators? You think God is not seeing the number of murderers? You think God is not seeing the number of wickedness going on? He grieves the heart of the Father. But who can bear the body? Who can bear it? Who can bear it? That's how you know strong men in war. You know what the Bible says concerning them? They keep them where the war is fierce. Those ones, they can bear the bodies. They are the intercessors. So when you fight war, there are places where only top generals stand. The place where one man can fight 800 men. If you take every other soldier there, they will die. They can't bear the body. He said, and the first three in rank, even Adoni the Esnite. He said at one point he took a spear and slew 800 men. Eleazar, the son of Dodo. All of them were soldiers, but they were 30 mighty men. Eleazar, he fought from morning till night until his hand became cleaved to the sword. The whole of Israeli army ran away. Only him stood there. You have not seen burden bearers. Sometimes because God apportioned 30 intercessors for Abba, 29 ran, only one is remaining. And because of the weight of burden he's carrying, he cannot even get a good job. Because of the weight of burden he's carrying, he marries at the age of 45. Because when others were to marry, he can't. All the other intercessors that should hold hands with him have run away. So the heat is always on him. If he leaves the place of prayer for one day, he travels to the village and God says, go back. And for 10 years, he has not traveled from Abba. You think he's a foolish man? No, he's carrying the weight of the city. So others can be running. Their life can be fast. So the guy had a bachelor's degree. He got a job. And 2 years later, he's a millionaire. This guy can't run fast because of the weight on his shoulders. What 30 men should carry? Only him is carrying it. So sometimes, he takes one step in 6 months. He takes another step in 6 months. So after 10 years, his life has not gone anywhere. And you look at him, you say, this man, when I don't get sense, so, are we, all of us not Christians? All of us are Christians, but some of us are warriors. Some of us are burden bearers. He said in Colossians 4:12, Epaphras is one of you, but he's different. He said, this one is a bond servant. You know who a bond servant is? He carries a yoke on his neck all the time. Epaphras cannot live his life until Colossus is perfect. So if you want to check the quality of Epaphras' life, don't check his car. Go and check Christianity in Colossus. Because the reason they are standing perfect is because Epaphras is bearing. Meanwhile, you'll be shocked that there are many intercessors that were apostles for Colossus, but they ran away. Only Epaphras too. He said, and Shammah, the son of Arche. He said, when they went to battle to keep the Lentiles, he said, Israel fled, but he stood his ground. And he fought from morning till night. And that day, God wrought a great victory. He didn't say Shammah wrought a great victory, because Shammah was only attending to the body in the heart of the Father. Makina Rakivo Vahata. Before you define Christianity, before you define success in the natural, go and check the spiritual template. I had opportunities of traveling out of the country. God says, stay in Makurdi. I was in Makurdi for 5 years doing a job earning 25,000 naira. The salary finishes the day I'm paid. Some of my friends had gone as far as Dubai. The other one was a lieutenant in the army. I had a better prospect than all of them. What is going on? And he said, read the scriptures. Fast, pray. Read the scriptures. Fast, pray. And I kept that routine for 8 years. And all of a sudden, he lifted the seal. And then what appeared was a Mustang. The order of the keepers. Before you say I'm a Christian, find out who you are in the kingdom. Meanwhile, that's not the highest. That's the beginning. This is where you just isolate the body in the heart of God. So you may just step out. You want to have a good day. Maybe the lady that you were praying to God for 5 years, finally she agreed. And the day you were supposed to go out on a date, God now say, don't go out for 3 days. Even you know you can't explain it to her. No way. She can't understand it. Meanwhile, if you take this decision, the relationship might be sabotaged. Because this lady, is after 5 years. This is the first time you have the opportunity of going out. God says, stay indoors. And sometimes say, off your phone. And then the lady calls you 10 times and your phone is off. And she feels you ditched her. And you, even you know, you won't call her again. But it's the body. And then you lose that relationship. You enter another one, you lose the relationship. And then a point comes, you now tell God, I'm a wretched man. I'm a wretched. You know, Moses began to cry in Numbers 11. Have I afflicted you, Lord? Why have you put this burden on my shoulder? Did I give birth to these children that I should give them suck? But a time came, Moses became a patriarch in Zion, not on earth, in heaven. So much so that they came to instruct Jesus Christ about what he will do in Jerusalem. Who is that man? He entered relevance in Zion by bodies. This is why Christianity, the peanut they give you in church can't take you anywhere. You will violate your ordination. Sit down. You want me to lose? I want to teach, but As I'm
talking now, you begin to understand why your life is the way it is. Because I'm not teaching Bible. These are prophetic utterances. I'm redefining your life. I'm telling you the story of your life. That's what I'm doing. I'm a prophetic teacher. This is not doctrine. I'm telling you the story of your life. Why some of you who even rebelled, you applied for that job 5 times, it failed. Why you took your credentials and the prophet prophesied that you will have a job, you still failed. That's the meaning. That's what I'm telling you. You are a burden bearer because you are in the order of keepers. You know, Jonah escaped mission. He came back in the belly of a fish. Relevance in the kingdom. Meanwhile, a man who have not journeyed this far is woed, because if we go to Zion and discover he never lived, he didn't live, he only existed. The first in the order of keepers are burden bearers. These are intercessors. See, this is not something you do in the flesh. So you don't just wake up and say, Lord, I'm carrying the burden of Abba. No, it is the one given to you, you will bear. So you don't choose the one you want. It's the Almighty that chooses for you. So your job is to discern. And so the journey of burden bearing begins from consciousness to yieldedness and to faith. You will first of all have to discern the movements of the Holy Ghost on your inside. So when God wants to give you a body, that's when he comes and starts giving you periodic instructions. Take 21 days fast. Take another 21 days fast. And a whole year you fasted all through the year. And then at the end of the year you found out, this fasting I fasted, what did I see in the spirit? You didn't see anything in the spirit realm. You are being re-engineered. There are certain prayers that lead you into sight. Other prayers re-engineer you. Because that your bogus appetite to become a millionaire at the age of 30 will sabotage this assignment. So God will deliberately shut you down for 3 years. I'm telling you, it's not something you carry out of zeal and ambition. You now say, I have the gate of the east. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking when you have journeyed through consciousness, yieldedness to the Holy Ghost, and you have discerned what God wants you to do. Moses struggled, nothing worked for 40 years. Until when he had stayed in the wilderness for 40 years, his ambitions had died. And in Exodus chapter 3 verse 1, he said, and Moses came to the backsides of Horeb, the mountain of God. That was when Moses understood the meaning of the previous 40 years. Because the previous 40 years did not make sense. God was re-engineering him to become a deliverer. How much burden do you carry? Every time you appear before God, oh Lord, see my house rent. Oh Lord, see these school fees. They say you love us. Peanut Christianity. The second rank in the order of keepers is the rank of warriors. When you have mastered the art of articulating burdens, God now sends you to the mission field. You know, the burden bearers are like those in battle who are cooking. So they say, take the food, they run, they go and deliver. Take the water, they run, they go and deliver. When God moves you from a burden bearer, he now takes you to battle. You become a warrior. As a burden bearer, your assignment is to beat your body and bring it under subjection. But as a warrior, your assignment is to war with spirits.
in Ephesians chapter 6 from verse 10, the Bible began to give us a lexicon of the kind of warfare that we will enter into. He said, finally, my brethren, finally, this instruction is not for babes. In Ephesians chapter 1, he showed us the eternal purpose of God. In Ephesians chapter 2, he showed us God's strategy of prosecuting salvation. In Ephesians chapter 3, he showed us how to walk in this life that we have received. In Ephesians chapter 4, he showed us the instructive syllabus, how he gave apostles to train us and how we should take off the old man and be clothed with the new man. In Ephesians chapter 5, he now begins to teach us how to relate with one another, your friends, your wife, your children, your servant. And when he finished all of that, he now came and said, finally, just in case you have perfected the act of living like a servant of God, he now said, there is something ahead. He said, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, wherewith you'll be able to stand the wiles of the devil. He said, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, and against spiritual wickedness in the heavenly places. He didn't say God is fighting. He said, we wrestle. You know, you can have a burden for righteousness, and then you are traveling everywhere preaching righteousness so that the people can repent. There's another person that has beyond the body. That one is a warrior against the prince of perversion. So while you are preaching righteousness, God will put that one behind closed doors, and then he will be fighting the prince of perversion. He will be fighting the prince of immorality. Now, when the prince of immorality is shifted, you, the preacher, you will come and say, we labored in this land. We taught them the ways of God. You don't know what happened at the back. You know, that's why sometimes we begin to preach as young preachers. We are everywhere. And then you see the fathers, they preach once in a month. You know, say, no, we are now on the scene. It's our time. You don't know who is actually on the show. The guy who stopped preaching is working harder than you. Because that guy may fast for 21 days every month, pray in tongues every day for 6 hours, and then he just throws out to supervise the impact of what he's doing in the closet. Meanwhile, you are preaching from January to December. You say, oh, when are we? You know, God is the mercy of God. When you begin to mature, you will retire from the pulpit. You will go back to the altar. When you mature, you retire from the pulpit, you go back to the altar. If you go to heaven, you'll be shocked. Myself and Lawrence were in a meeting in Nusuka early this year, and one of those strange men, he came out of the cave, Pastor Hassan. And then when he saw me, he said, brother, God bless you. And he was walking like, he went to his room. We didn't see him again until the day he will minister. And then as he ministers, he goes back to the room. If his next session is after 2 days, see, when you are talking, it's noise. Hi, hi. He's not used to mortars again. He's so close to the, you know, when the man came, he started preaching. After 30 minutes, he started crying. He couldn't hold himself again. He said, Lord, you know how hard it is for me to preach, you know. Meanwhile, you are a prolific preacher. You have utterance. No, utterance is not the altar. It's when you engage a spirit that you will see the beauty of utterance. Because utterance is the ability to negotiate with a spirit. It's not just the ability to communicate the heart of God to the heart of man. The higher realm of utterance is the ability to negotiate with a spirit. It was Abraham that stood with God and said, far be it from you that the just God of all should destroy the righteous and the wicked. What if you find 50 righteous men? That is utterance. What God concluded in Zion came to earth to do. God was such in a hurry, a man of utterance stopped him. And he began to talk with God. He spoke until he brought God to 10. When he felt that Lot lands up, he said, okay, go, at least 10 people. So men of utterance can cause God to change his mind. That's utterance. That's why when you become mature, you leave the pulpit. You leave it for younger preachers. You go to the altar, where you begin to war with spirits and negotiate in light. is the stand of warriors. I will destroy these people and start a new generation with you, for they are a stiff-necked people. And Moses told God, how can it be heard of the righteous God? Exodus 32, from verse 31 to 32. You want it to be heard that you deliver them from Egypt and destroy them in the wilderness? He said, if you will not change your mind, remove my name from the book of life. The book of life, you are struggling with that. I want to make heaven. A man have graduated in the spirit so high. And the threat he had for God was, remove my name from the book of life. That's utterance. He can negotiate. See, there are certain men that when they kneel down, princes are shifted. Daniel knelt down for 21 days until God was in a hurry. God dislodged Gabriel. As if it was not enough, he dislodged Michael. And Gabriel said they fought for 21 days. And when Gabriel came, he said, I came to give you skill and understanding. He said, for I was made to fly swiftly. Because of the quality of negotiation that Daniel was carrying out, suddenly Gabriel didn't know how to fly again. God had to add another energy to Gabriel in the spirit realm to fly faster. So by reason of Daniel's intercession, Gabriel's rank was increased in the angelic rank. That's utterance. Spirit energized communication is the lowest level of utterance. A higher realm of utterance is legislation in the spirit. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. What will you tell a principality that he will shift from a territory? Do you know how they engage? They came to Jesus and said, if you are the Son of God, and they began to weave scriptures, manipulate scripture, and Jesus followed him and was unloosing. See, if you can't legislate in the spirit, you can't be a warrior. Being a warrior is not running in the prayer altar. No. When you pray, find out what is the burden in your heart. Some of us have no burden for anything. It's only for what to eat and drink. That's why we are small. And then when you journey beyond there, you begin to find out, how many princes have you met? How many? One came to my room. He came out of the war with terrible horn to intimidate me. I fell down. My brother. Love him out. Oh, velele, fufu bahaka haya. Oh, awala. My brother, no scriptures before. Don't worry, let me not go there. I fell down and I said, Jesus, save me. And the guy stopped and he said, you will end on the lap of a woman. Since you don't want us to rest, we will disgrace you publicly. You will end on the lap of a woman. You don't know why men of God fall. I told you, discipline is the lowest level. If anybody is blessing you, the best thing to do, pray for him. Pray for him before you sow seed. A prince, you will end. Warriors. What do you engage? They come and tell you funny things, garbage, biscuit that you eat. Take a 6 months fast and be consistent in prayer for 3-4 hours every day, and come back. You will tell me whether your Christian testimony will be the same. That's when you will even understand the potency of scriptures. The way of keepers. These are honors. See, these are honors in the kingdom. When we go to heaven, we will not all be the same. Don't deceive yourself. We will not all be the same. You have the victory, but God selects you to fight to keep the victory. Adam did not know that even though he had Eden, his battle was to keep that victory. And the prince came and deceived him, and he fell. The third rank in the order of keepers is the rank of guardians. The rank of guardians. These men have become like cherubims among men. The reason you see some men of God, you want to faint, is not because they manipulate you. It's the energy level where they come from. They have become like covering cherubs. That's in the spirit, they are guardians. The reason some of you are standing is not because you are an upright Christian. It's because of a covering of another person over your life. Jesus came, he said, Simon, Simon, Satan desires to have you, to sift you like wheat. He said, I have prayed for you that your faith faileth not. He said, when thou art recovered, strengthen thy brethren. What was Jesus saying? Today I am here as your covering, but when I go, you become the covering of the others. These are honors in Zion. Honors. You see why sometimes one man is more important than 100 men. And then you come and say, we are all the same. We are all born again. You are a babe. You have not done business in deep waters. You come and say, all these fathers have failed. They will die. You are a joker. Some of them are no longer on earth for ministry. They are here to preserve a generation. If they live here, wolves will enter. They are guardians. They have done business on the altar to a point where God apportions the security of others to them. In Galatians 4:19, he said, my little children, of whom I travail again in prayer until Christ be formed in you. He said, again in prayers, they have lost their first love. It was not God that was coming this time. It was Paul that was restoring them. He's a guardian. This is what intercession is about. It's not the fun in the prayer room. It is the rank you are gaining on the altar. In Acts chapter 20 verse 28 to 30, Paul said he called the elders in Ephesus and he spoke to them from night to morning, and this was Paul's heart cry. He said, if I leave you, wolves will come among you to take and to make disciples after themselves. So the reason those guys are standing is because Paul was there. Paul knows that if he pulls away, they will become vulnerable. The Holy Ghost is here with them. He didn't say they will lose the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is still with them. But the guardian have been withdrawn. So they become vulnerable. You see how men become relevant with God. This is why one man is not praying, yet angels are guarding him. Another man is praying, yet he's dying. He has no value. The best thing for him is to go back to heaven, at least to preserve his salvation. He said, precious in the eyes of the Lord is the dying of the saints. Before he loses his salvation, you come home, come home. Epaphras is one of you, Colossians 4:12, laboring fervently for you in prayers that you will stand perfect. He said, we have the scriptures. We have the Holy Ghost. You are a joker. You don't know the men that keep the vault and the gates in the spirit for you to I'm not showing you this thing to exhort men. That's why I'm not calling people's name, but I'm showing you so that you will become zealous for God and you will make up your mind to be relevant in Zion, because the path to relevance is not how many congregations you have. The path to relevance is not how much seed you receive. The path to relevance is not how famous you are. The path to relevance is the nature of your assignment in the spirit. A guardian may no longer have a congregation. He may just sit in his house quietly. But because he's there, because he is there, the wolves cannot come. This is what intercession does for us. So when we are stirring ourselves us to pray, it's beyond having an answer. Having an answer is a part of it. Is becoming mighty men in the kingdom. They are guardians. So all of us may be praying. Some may be intercessors. Some may be warriors. Others may be guardians. So the intercessor can isolate the burden in the heart of the Father, and you people will pray it. The warrior can be contending in the spirit to keep the integrity of the fellowship. But the fellowship will remain because the guardian is there. If the guardian is removed, the fellowship will die. Have you not seen many churches? The moment the man providing the covering is lifted, the ministry becomes a shadow of itself. Message the same, but essence altered because guardian has been removed. So when you raise men, before you teach them how to preach, teach them how to pray. Jesus never taught anybody how to preach, but he taught his disciples how to pray. Because if you can pray, you will be a great preacher. Meanwhile, impact is not where you are. An impact is not how many messages you have on YouTube. Impact is the ripple effect that your presence causes in the spirit realm. You may have only 3 messages online, but you may be the reason why others are preaching in the first place. Guardians. Are you learning something? When you pray, this is your focus. If you come for that prayer and you are always being motivated to come, go and cry. What is happening to that person who is always coming to lead the prayer? Who always comes first to the prayer? The guy who prays the prayer as if it's his property. What happens to him that is not happening to me? He has a burden you don't have. So while they are praying, trust God for a body, because that body has become the fuel. The reason they never get tired is because they are not spending from ATP. They are spending from the burden in their heart. You don't have a burden. That's why you pray for 30 minutes, you are tired. And tomorrow is difficult to come back. And then others journey, they become warriors. They become guardians. And then you think we are the same. A friend of mine told me once, he said, me and him were jogging. And as we were jogging, after a while, he saw that I flew into the heaven so high because our wings came. And then his own wing came and he flapped. He fell down. He was struggling, flapping. While I left him and went far. My brother, see, it's the way of eagles. But you go there by deliberately consecrating to God on the altar of prayer. Before you struggle to be known by men, fight to be known by spirits. He said, Jesus, we know. Paul, we know. Who art thou? That's why Paul can boldly tell you, if I leave, wolves will come. Because even in the demonic ranking, they know him. They know that he's a prince. He's a prince. He's a prince. This is not an attempt to tell you to become useless in life. No. Not at all. But it's teaching you prioritization. That there is a higher purpose for existence beyond bread and wine. The fourth rank in the order of keepers are watchers. You see what I told you when I saw the conference of watchmen? I said, God, help us. Because I was wondering, will I meet intercessors here? Will I meet intercessors? Let alone warriors, then guardians. Before we talk about watchmen, I will show you who a watchman is. A watchman is not just a man that sees. The watchman sees because he's a watchman. So the duty of the watchman is beyond seeing. The first duty of the watchman is to see, but it's beyond seeing. When he sees, he alarms the armory to enact judgment. In Daniel chapter 4, verse 17. See how watchman responsibility is carried out in the ranking of the angelic. A king was misbehaving. You will understand that watchers are actually the keepers of the jealousy of God. A man becomes a watchman when he can keep the jealousy of God. In Daniel 4:17, before that scripture, the king was messing up. God did nothing about it. And they saw a watcher descending from heaven. And when the watcher present the scripture, I want everybody to see it. Daniel 4:17. The watcher showed up, and then he passed a judgment against the king. And I thought it was God. I thought it was God. And it was not God. Who is on the scripture? Can you project Daniel 4:17? Or do we need to look closely and find out if a spirit has bound your fingers? Because sometimes I deliberately calm myself down because you won't get it. I'm showing you how you journey. You may be praying for 5 years, but you have not even become an intercessor. Because you have never caught one body and prayed a body, not once. Are you checking where you are currently in your intercessory campaign? If I ask you now, you will know whether you are an intercessor or you are still learning prayer. He said this matter is the decree of the waters. The judgment that was passed was not the decree of God. It was the decree of the waters. And he said the demand by the word of the holy ones. Those are the keepers of the jealousy of God in Zion. They saw a king misbehaving. They were moved on behalf of God and they judged the king. In Luke chapter 1, the angel came and he gave a word to Zacharias. He doubted it and he said, "You doubt my word." He said, "Because of that, you become dumb." So watchers are actually judges. They have the authority with God to bring judgment on behalf of God. If you study Acts of the Apostles, chapter 13 from verse 11, Paul came to a city trying to bring the gospel to one of the rulers. And he said, Elymas, the sorcerer, was withstanding him. And Paul looked at him. And Paul said, because of this evil that he has done, he will be blind for a season. You know, there are people that come and say, in the New Testament, we don't judge, we don't curse. It's not about us, it's about the assignment. Angels are not killers. But when there is a need to kill in the will of God, they will execute it. You know, believers have not reached a rank where they take up kingdom responsibilities so they can be neutral. There's a realm where you enter. You know, because God killeth and maketh alive, there are times when God wants to kill, and it is a watcher that will carry out the assignment. He said, you will be blind for a season. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter 5, Ananias came to bring evil to the foundation of the church that they were building. The church was infant. And Peter said, why has he entered your heart? Why has he entered your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit? He fell down and died. The wife came in 3 hours later. He asked him, did you sell this land for such and so? He said, yes. He said, the feet of them that carry thy husband at the door, they will carry you. She fell down and died. And in verse 17, he said, fear gripped the people. That's the job of a watcher. He's a judge in the spirit. He's a preserver of the jealousy of God. As our intercession grows, a point will come when we become watchers. And when we become watchers, what we see is what is in the heart of God. And if we can as much as see it, we will pass verdict on ground and they will come to pass. That's how tall intercession is in spiritual ranking. The fifth rank are custodians. Custodians, they are keepers of the secrets of God. There's a place you journey to that the secrets of God will become your asset. Why men have cars as asset? You have secrets. You know what to tell somebody to prosper. You know what to do to prosper. You don't need to labor like others. The cloud may not be full of rain, but the ditches, they must be filled, because the man knows secrets. When we engage intercession, the final rank we enter into is to become custodians of the mysteries of God. And it is by mystery that we rule in this realm. The Bible spoke in Luke chapter 2, verse 25 and 27 concerning Anna, Simon the prophet. He said it had been revealed to him that he will not see death until the coming of the salvation of Israel. So long as Simon was alive, Jesus must be born. He becomes the testimony of that which God wants to do. He's a keeper of mystery. This is not just revelation into the word of God. This is actually where you get to, and God hides himself in your life. And every time you come, you become an evolution of God. This is the journey we travel in intercession. And this is why intercession becomes one of the highest services in the kingdom. Because there's a realm where you can articulate the burden in the heart of God and you express it. So you are the one who gives God ventilation in the spirit. There's a realm where you get to, and then you become a warrior on behalf of God. So you are the one who fight the battles of God. There's a realm where you get to, where you become the guardian over the inheritances of God. So God will not stress himself. So long as you are there, he knows that his heritages will be kept. In John 17 verse 12, Jesus said, I have kept them by the power of your name. And there's a realm where you get to, and you become a custodian, the keeper of the secrets of God. This is how we rule in this realm. And when we come for a conference like this, we understand intercession from a higher plane, and then it helps us to commit ourselves more to intercession. So when next you pray, results are not your motivation. Will the results be there? Yes. Should they be there? Yes. But beyond result, you are becoming something in God. And then you can bring representation to the purposes of God beyond what can be imagined. Then, yourself become a wonder in the spirit realm. Even the principalities and powers, they will put a star on your name and say, don't touch this one. Because this one is not a man. This one has a rank in the angelic realm. Even if he were to go to heaven today, they will not be surprised. Because he traffics that realm normally. That's where men like Bob Jones entered. And Bob Jones could literally traffic heaven. So much so that if Jesus visited you, Bob Jones will be aware. He's a custodian. These are the things that should provoke and to stir your appetite. If you become a custodian, the things men labor for will happen to you by free course. It's only Christians that take these things for granted. The guy who is selling pure water and yet one of the richest men in the land, he knows the altar he services. He knows it's not by the business. He knows the business is only a channel for that spirit to express himself. Tonight you want to pray one prayer. You say, Lord, make me an intercessor. That's our prayer. Bow your heads and pray. It's bigger than an impartation. We can change the atmosphere in less than 2 minutes and begin to release impartations. But if this ability is formed and this conviction is nurtured, you will be amazed what you will become in the next 5 years. You will be so shocked. These are the things I stumbled upon, and I told myself, in this kingdom, only God makes men. Because if you know these things and you give yourself to it, even if men come together and say you will fail, faith, they can't stop you. The Bible says 50 men bound themselves by a vow, and they say if they don't keep Paul, they will not eat. They actually died because they didn't keep Paul. It doesn't matter who is against you. A whole nation can come together. They fought Isaac, but they couldn't stop him. A point came, they say, leave us, you are bigger than us. Laban tried to frustrate him. He couldn't. He said, I have come to understand by divination that God has blessed me because of you. There's a realm where men get to and they become bigger than systems. There's a realm where men get to and they become indestructible. This is the channel. It was Lawrence that was sharing yesterday that you don't need to go to a meeting to have an encounter. If you are deliberate about it in your room, you can become a general in this kingdom. From your room, a scepter can meet you in your room. It was at the backside of the desert that God met Moses. He was not in a church service. A scepter can literally meet you in your room if you know what to do there. Mande frahasivi kazizi vahel de vanak zili gavadi valavanera varas. Lord, bless me with hunger. Bless me with burdens. Make me an intercessor. Make me a watcher. Make me a guardian. Make me a custodian. I want to grow in the things of the Spirit.